Have you ever seen one of those signs indicating the occupant capacity of a room and thought, how exactly do they get that number? If you thought it was how many people could be physically packed into the room shoulder to shoulder, then no, that's most likely not it. Occupant loads are, for the most part, determined by means of egress, which basically means the design of exiting components throughout the space, as well as the number of available sanitary fixtures such as toilets and lavatories. So how are these components designed to meet the intended occupant load? Egress is arguably one of the most important aspects of architectural and interior design. The exiting requirements for proper and safe evacuation depends largely on what the space is being used for. For example, a movie theater will usually hold more people compared to a typical office of the same size. And a storage room carrying flammable liquids is more dangerous than a typical residential dwelling. Building codes also differ depending on where you are. Here in North America, most states, provinces, and municipalities will adopt model building codes, such as the International Building Code or National Building Code of Canada. For this video, I will refer mostly to the IBC. In order to determine egress provisions, we need to figure out how many people are expected to use a space. In a space that only contains fixed seats, like a movie theater, it's pretty straightforward to figure that out. It can be done by counting the number of seats. But what about spaces without fixed seating? Well, another method is to use the occupant load factor table provided in the building code. For example, the load factor of an exhibit gallery or museum is 30 square feet per occupant. So in a 3,000 square feet room, the occupant load for an art gallery would be 100. In business areas, such as an office, the load factor is 150 square feet per occupant. So in the same space, the occupant load for an office would be 20. The load factor table, however, does not restrict the space from having more occupants. The 3,000 square feet gallery can be designed for more than 100 people, as long as the requirements for egress, life safety, sanitary fixtures, and other code mandates are satisfied. The more difficult thing to do is designing the space for less occupants than what's specified by the load table. So if you're trying to argue that this 3,000 square feet gallery will only be used by a maximum of 25 people at any given time, then you need to make a good case to the local building official and they would have to approve it. So let's talk exits, or more accurately, means of egress. What exactly is a means of egress? Well, the IBC defines it as a continuous and unobstructed path of vertical and horizontal egress travel from any occupied portion of a building or structure to a public way. The reason we talk about it in this way is because exiting a building is not a one-step event. It's a process that involves multiple exiting components. So, pretty obvious, every space needs at least one means of egress, but two or more means of egress are required if the space exceeds a certain occupant load under certain occupancy classifications. Occupancy classifications are formal designations for the primary purpose of a building or portion of a building. Since art galleries normally fall under the assembly occupancy, we would look under the requirements for occupancy A, which indicates that if the space only has one means of egress, the occupant load cannot exceed 49. In our case of 100 occupants, we would have to provide two means of egress. Exits or access to exits also have to be positioned and spaced accordingly, because say there is a fire blocking the path to one doorway, there needs to be an alternative way to get out. You can't just have two doors next to each other and call that two exits. They have to be certain distances apart. And the distances are based on ratios and formulas outlined by the code, which may vary depending on if the building is sprinklered or not. The means of egress also have to be large enough to handle the occupant load. For example, doorways and corridors along a means of egress must have a clear headroom of 80 inches high, have a minimum cleared width of 32 inches for doors, 36 inches for corridors, 44 inches for corridors serving an occupant load of 50 or more, or 0.2 inches multiplied by the occupant load, whichever is more. These width capacities may be reduced in certain occupancies if the space is equipped with an automatic sprinkler system. Going back to our art gallery that require two means of egress, let's say they are exit access doorways. Since 0.2 inches times 100 is only 20 inches, in this case, both doors have to be at least 32 inches wide each. This is not necessarily the size of the door though, it's actually the clear opening between any protruding hardware when the door is open at 90 degrees. So often a 36-inch door needs to be used to achieve a 32-inch opening. Let's take a look at an example with a higher occupant load. For instance, a community meeting room with loose seating. This usage, as per the load factor table, is listed as 7 square feet per occupant. So in our 3,000 square feet room, we could expect 429 people, which when multiplied by 0.2 inches would equal 85.8 inches. Since we definitely need at least two exits or exit access doorways, one way to achieve this is by having two doors, each having a clear width of at least 42.9 inches. In high hazard occupancies and in all other occupancies where the occupant load of the space is 50 or more, the door also must swing in the direction of exit travel. Occupant loads above certain capacities may also trigger life safety and fire protection requirements, such as requirements for automatic sprinklers and fire alarm systems. But while life safety and means of egress are very important building components, so are personal hygiene and access to toilets. Thus, building codes mandate a minimum number of toilets, lavatories, drinking fountains, service sinks, and sometimes also bathtubs and showers. As per IBC, in the office area, we would need to provide one water closet for every 25 persons of each sex for the first 50 people. Since we only have 20 people, that's 10 males and 10 females, we could provide one restroom per sex. However, there is an exception in the code where you do not need to provide a separate facility for each sex in business occupancies of 25 or less. So in this case, providing one restroom total is acceptable. In addition, based on our occupant load, a minimum of one lavatory, one drinking fountain, and one service sink are also required. In the community meeting room of 429 people, the requirement is one water closet for every 65 females and one for every 125 males. Since we have about 215 of each sex, this means we need four water closets for women and two for men. In the female restroom, this would mean four toilets. In the male restroom, up to half of toilets can be urinals. In case you're wondering why women get more toilets than men, this is due to the fact that biologically, it takes longer for women to use the restroom. Additionally, one lavatory is required for every 200 people of each sex. This means we need two lavatories for both restrooms. And one drinking fountain and one service sink are also required. Essentially, every built environment needs to be designed to allow its occupants to exit safely in a timely manner in the event of an emergency and provide adequate toilet and personal hygiene facilities for its occupants. While the examples I've given in this video are relatively simple, there are more complex requirements. Plus, real-world environments are generally not as straightforward and often deal with existing construction, mixed occupancies, and municipal regulations. Thus, most of the time, load calculations and code reviews must be carried out by a licensed interior designer or architect. I find that a lot of people perceive creative design to be dominated by form and aesthetics, when in reality, form is often secondary to function, and design can be quite a constrained exercise with a lot of limitations. However, personally, I think working with constrained parameters is even more interesting and, as a matter of fact, requires even more creativity. Thanks for watching. This episode is a part of a series where I explore the various aspects of the interior design profession. If you liked it, then you may enjoy some of these as well. And please subscribe to keep watching. Until next time.